Good afternoon, students. Today we are going to see the position telemetry system, so which is the one of the type of the landline telemetry system. So in the landline telemetry system, we have the different types, which is nothing but voltage telemetry system, current telemetry system, position telemetry system. So we have seen the voltage telemetry system. This is the voltage telemetry system. We are sending the information from the transmitter to the receiver in terms of the voltage, means the electrical signal which we are using for transmission is the voltage, and at the destination it is going to receive the voltage information but shows the information in terms of means, displays the information in terms of the pressure, displays the information in terms of the pressure. So we tune the potentiometer to display the value in terms of the pressure. So that is the voltage telemetry system. So this is a current telemetry system, one type of current telemetry system. In this case, we are sending the information in terms of the current instead of the voltage. So there are some drawbacks when we are sending the signal in terms of the voltage. So to overcome that one, we are having the alternating telemetry system, which is nothing but the current telemetry system. And in the current telemetry system, we have seen two different types. One is a motion balance telemetry system and a force balance telemetry system. So this is a diagram for motion balance telemetry system, and this is a diagram for force balance telemetry system. Force balance telemetry system. So the next case is a position telemetry system. The next one is a position telemetry system. So there are two different ways in transmitting the information using the position telemetry system. So the basic diagram is a basic position telemetry system is this one, which is there on the board. Okay, now so here what we are doing is we are using the contact potentiometers, which are acting as a sliding wire. So here I am using the potentiometer, and here also I am using the potentiometer. So initially we are assuming that these two potentiometer positions are in the same point, at the same position. So if it means the transmitter, whatever the potentiometer which we are having in the transmitting end, and whatever the potentiometer which we are having in the receiving end, I am assuming that those positions are in the same, means those sliding contact point is in the same position. If at all there is a change in the transmitting one, we are sending the information now, so we are using the Bowden tube in order to sense the pressure physical variable. In order to sense the pressure which is a physical variable, what we are doing is we are using the Bowden tube. Okay, so this particular Bowden tube is used as a sensor, that is nothing but the transducer. So based on this particular transducer, the sliding contact is going to be changes its position either towards the upward direction or in the downward direction. So whenever there is a slight change in the position of this particular sliding contact, at that time the same change is going to be reflected in the receiving end. Okay, now so means when there is a change in the sliding contact position, this change is going to be transferred through the telemetering system. Through the telemetering system, at the destination we are using the another sliding contact potentiometer in such a way that depending on the information coming through this particular telemetering system, the sliding contact is going to adjust its position. The sliding contact is going to adjust its position in such a way that the position of this particular receiving end and the position of the transmitting end are at the same position. And another end of this particular sliding contact is connected to the scale, which is going to be shows the information in terms of the pressure, which is a kilo newton per meter square range. Okay, so this is a pressure scale. So the one end, one terminal is going to be connected to this particular sliding contact in such a way that whenever there is a change in the position of this particular sliding contact, the same change is going to be reflected on the scale to indicate that how much pressure we are sensing from the Bowden tube. So here we are simply having the two potentiometers. This particular one, the third terminal is acting as a changing the position with respect to the Bowden tube information. Means the information coming from the Bowden tube, this particular sliding contact is going to be changing its position. So when there is a change in the position of the sliding contact in the transmitting terminal, the same information is going to be transferred to the telemetering system to the receiving end. In the receiving end, as there is a change and that information is passed through the telemetering channel, this end is going to be adjust its position. So after when it is adjusting in linear to this particular adjustment, this pointer is going to be moved on this particular scale. So this scale is going to be shows the information in terms of the pressure. This scale is going to be shows the information in terms of the pressure. So this is about the position tilt metering system using a bridge type configuration. Bridge type configuration in the sense, we have seen the Wheatstone bridge concept, right? We have seen the Wheatstone bridge concept. When we are taking the Wheatstone bridge, it is including the four arms. So initially we are going to adjust that particular bridge to give the null reading, okay, now to give the zero balanced reading. We are simply adjusting the four arms in the Wheatstone bridge. One of the arm is going to be acting as a transducer. I think you would have seen this one in the instrumentation amplifier during the third semester. We have taken one temperature sensor that is going to be placed, temperature sensor that is going to be placed in one arm of the Wheatstone bridge, and we are adjusting the voltage applied to that particular circuit to give the balanced condition. Once it is in the balanced condition, it is ready for measuring the variations in the physical quantities which we are interested to measure. Okay, now, so that is what we have seen in the instrumentation amplifier. Similar to that, here in the balanced condition, means once the bridge is in the balanced condition, whenever there is a change in the physical parameter, like temperature or pressure, whatever it is, so the transducer resistance is going to be changes. When the transducer resistance is changing in the forearm of Wheatstone bridge, obviously the bridge is going to be unbalanced, and that unbalanced value is going to be our reading. So that is what we have seen here. Also same thing, initially we are adjusting these two sliding contact parts in such a way that they are acquiring the same position. So once we start the measuring the things, at that time the body tube is going to be used the information in such a way that it is going to be moves the sliding contact with respect to the transmitting end. When there is a change in the position of the sliding contact in the transmitting end, so the bridge is going to be unbalanced. That information is going to be transferred to the receiving end. In the receiving end, in order to bring that, how much position is changed in the transmitting end, to bring the receiving end sliding contact to the same position, this information is going to be passed to this particular sliding contact, so that it is going to be adjusted itself to the same position, the position which is acquired by the transmitting end. So when there is a this particular terminal is changing its position, which is called as a sliding contact, the same thing is going to be connected. Means we are using one more needle to point the information on the pressure scale. So whenever there is a change, obviously this needle is going to be changing its position, and whatever the value you are reading, measuring from this particular scale, that is going to become your pressure value, pressure sensed by the Bowden tube. So means these two are synchronized. Means whenever there is a change, depending on that change, the pointer which is moving on this particular scale is going to be changes. The pointer which is moving on this particular scale is going to be points how much pressure which is experienced by the Bowden tube. So this is a basic explanation of the position tilt metering system. And we can construct the same position tilt metering system with the help of the synchro transmitter and receiver. So why they are called as a synchro transmitter and receiver means they are working on the principle of motion of the wire. Motion of the wire in the sense, what we are going to do means the synchro transmitter receiver is going to be constructed with the help of the designed synchro transmitter receiver design with the help of the mechanical devices. Those mechanical devices are working based on the angular position changes. Okay, now so they are working based on the angular position means whenever there is a change in the position of the rotor. So which means before going to the synchro transmitter and receiver, let us recollect some information related to the stepper motor. So in the stepper motor, we are having stator as well as the rotor. The stepper motor, it is not the stepper motor, any motor, simple way is any motor. Motor is nothing but which converts the electrical energy into the mechanical energy, as well as sometimes the mechanical energy converted back into the electrical energy with the help of the motors. We have seen some scenarios. Okay, now, so here, as we studied the stepper motor during the practical case, let me take that example in order to explain the synchro transmitter and receiver. So there in the stepper motor we are using the stator as well as the rotor. So depending on the voltage which is going to be applied or depending on the current which is applied to the stator wires, is nothing but it is a coils, a group of coils arranged in one order. We have seen that one. I'll show those diagrams in the next coming classes when we are going to study about the stepper motor. But I have shown the same slides in the classroom also. Just recollect that information. We are having the stators as well as a rotor. Okay, now one rotor is there and multiple stators are there. It depends on whether it is a four wire, four coils, or 10 coils, or 12 coils. That purely depends on the type of the stepper motor which we are using. The scenario is there. The rotor is going to be get rotated depending on the electric field which we are applying to the stators, which we are applying to the stators. In another case is when the rotor is going to be getting rotated, then there is a reverse propagation, means there is a electromagnetic field, EMF is going to be induced in the stators, and it is going to be shown as a voltage difference across the stator windings, which we call it as a converting the mechanical energy into the electrical energy. Okay, in this case, the synchro transmitter and receiver is nothing but they are working same based on the same principle which we have seen for stepper motor. So there we are using the rotor. In the synchro transmitter receiver also, we are having the one motor which includes the rotor as well as the stator, Okay, now. So whatever the information, this particular rotor, whatever the rotor and stator which we are having, that particular rotor is going to be changes its position. So that for changing the position of that particular rotor is called as a angular position change. Angular position change of our rotor. Whenever the angular position is changed, angular position of rotor is changed, obviously the stators are going to be induced some EMF. So this is the converting the mechanical energy into the electrical energy. So if you want to see that one, let me take one simple example. Let me give 2 minutes of time because I think, it is not required. We have already seen that one, so I'm not going with that. If you want, I'll show that later. So the thing is, we are having the rotor as well as the stator. Otherwise, I'll show something. Let me take that. I'll show you something. Wait a minute. Into stitch. Okay. Let me show you that one. So I'm not taking the exact figure, I'm just giving a rough figure to explain. Just recollect which we have seen in the lab case. So we are having the stator 1 first end, stator 1 second end, stator 2 first end, stator 2 second end. This is a freely rotatable one, right? This one is going to be changes its position, south pole and north pole position, depending on how the electromagnetic field is going to be generated by these coils. Depending on the electromagnetic field generated by these coils, the rotor is going to be get rotated either in the clockwise direction or in the anti-clockwise direction. In another way is, if we are able to rotate, let us suppose I am not applying the power supply to the stators. If I am applying the, electrical field, this particular rotor or something to this rotor in such a way that it is going to get rotate. So whenever it is going to get rotate, so same this mechanical energy means getting rotating a particular rotor is nothing but giving the mechanical energy. So when you are rotating this particular rotor, obviously there is an EMF induced in these particular stators. The EMF is going to be induced in this particular stators that we are going to observe as a voltage difference or the potential difference. Okay, now. So this conversion is called as a converting the mechanical energy into the electrical energy. One way is applying the electrical energy and converting the electrical energy into the mechanical energy. Another way is converting the mechanical energy into the electrical energy. So this kind of type of concept we are using in the what we say the synchro transmitter and receiver. We are using in the synchro transmitter and receiver. Okay. So here I am assuming that this is a synchro transmitter and this is a synchro receiver. So the concept, whatever the concept which we are seeing in this case, so that is looks like this. We are having the rotor now. Rotor is indicated using the a coil. So here also we are using the this particular rotor is indicated using the coil. In the receiving end also the rotor is going to be indicated using the coil. So here whenever you are trying to use the position telemetering system using the synchros, we are interested to measure what? We are interested to measure the physical quantities. That particular what is the transducer which converts the physical energy into the electrical energy, that particular transducer is going to be connected to this one, to which variable you would like to measure. That transducer is connected to this particular rotor. When it is connected to this particular rotor, the rotor is going to be changes its position because of the measured value. When there is a change in the position of the rotor, then this change is going to be induced into this status as a EMF. Induced into this status as a EMF. And when there is a change in the EMF, which is induced in this particular stator coil, the same change is going to be reflected in the receiving end. So this is a transmitting end and this is a receiving end. So from the initially, means before using the before start the telemetering system, what they are going to do means they are going to adjust this particular rotor position, means angular position with respect to the null value. So we are expecting that whenever we are adjusting this rotor to a particular position, we are expecting the receiver rotor is also in the same angular position. Receiver rotor also in the same angular position. Now, because of there is a variation, means these two are in the same position, means the induced EMF over here as well as the induced EMF over here, both are equal. So when there is a when the induced EMF in the transmitting end stator and the receiving end stator both are having the equal EMF, then the current passing through this particular channel is going to be zero. The current passing through this particular channel is going to be zero. So now, whenever there is a change in the rotor, whenever there is a change in the position of the rotor from the transmitting end, as there is a change, this change is going to be converted into the electrical field format that is going to be induced inside this particular stator as a EMF. Okay, so when there is a change in the EMF of the transmitting stator with respect to the receiving stator, then there is a potential difference between these two stators. So when there is a potential difference, then the current is going to be passed from the transmitting end to the receiving end. Up to what time? Up to the receiver rotor is going to be readjust its position to the position similar to the transmitting rotor. Readjust its position to the position similar to the transmitting rotor. So this is another kind of position telemetering system. So in the position telemetering system, we may use the sliding contact potentiometer. Another one is we can use the synchro trans receiver. We can use the synchro transmitter as well as the receiver. So the synchro transmitter receivers are working based on the stators as well as the rotor. The motor concept which we have seen in case of the stepper motor. Okay, now. So this is about what the position telemetering system. So with this, the landline telemetering system is over. So what we have seen in the landline telemetering system, we have seen three types of landline telemetering system. So landline telemetering system is divided into three types: voltage, current, position. Depending on how the information is going to be transferred, based on that, this division is done. Voltage telemetering system, in this case, information is going to be transferred in the voltage format. Current telemetering system, in this case, the current is going to be transferred. Position telemetering system, whenever there is a change in the position of the rotor in the transmitter, in order to bring the position of the receiver receiving rotor to the same position, the information is going to be transferred from there is a EMF difference between the transmitter and the receiver. In this case, between the transmitter and receiver, there is a EMF change from the stator to from the stator of the transmitter to the receiver of the transmitter. So when there is a EMF change, then obviously the current is going to be passed from the transmitter to the receiver, so that the received current is going to be takes a responsibility to rotate the stepper rotor to a particular angular position which is similar to the transmitting rotor angular position. So this is all about our position telemetering system. The next case is a landline telemetering system. Okay, now
So landline telemetering system with the feedback system. Landline telemetering system with the feedback system. Feedback system is nothing but, what is the use of the feedback system? All of you know, right? Right? So we have taken the open loop control system as well as the closed loop control system. So we are having the open loop control system as well as the closed loop control system. What is the difference between the open loop and closed loop? In the open loop, the output parameter is not going to be controlled automatically. In the closed loop, the output parameter is going to be controlled automatically. So that is the main intention, main difference between the closed loop as well as the open loop. So in the closed loop, the output is going to be controlled based on a part of the output is taken and compared with the reference signal. So whenever there is a change, based on that change, the output is going to be controlled. So that part, whatever the path which we are using to bring the a part of the output to the input, that path is called as a feedback. So here we are going for the landline feedback telemetry system, means landline telemetry system with the help of the feedback. So here we are taking, what we are doing is we are taking the two-wire communication as well as the three-wire communication. We are taking the two-wire communication as well as the three-wire communication. So whenever we are taking the communication path, that is the two-wire or the three-wire, we should be more aware of that particular wire characteristics. The first thing is wire characteristics means those wires should satisfy certain characteristics like resistance, and when we are using them as a transmitting medium, what is the resistance of that particular path, as well as are they transmitting the information from one position to other position, means whether they are affecting due to the external noises or not. All those things we are supposed to consider. Okay, now. So based on that, we are going for the two-wire or the three-wire communication. Okay, now. So in the voltage telemetry system as well as in the control telemetry, current telemetry system also, we can use the feedback loops. We can use the feedback paths. So here, landline telemetry system. In the landline telemetry system, we are going with the, feedback format. We are going with the explanation of the feedback format. So here I am assuming that this is a beam, which is a freely movable one, and this beam is going to be moving either to the upward direction or to the downward direction, depending on the input which is going to be sensed by this particular spring. Whenever it is going to be sensing some input at that time, the beam is going to be moved either in the upward direction or in the downward direction. So this particular beam, when this particular beam is changing its position, then we are having the position detector. We are having the position detector to sense what is the present position of the beam, as well as we are having the force motor. So when the beam is changing, it is changing with some force. Now, this particular force motor takes the responsibility to convert this particular mechanical energy only, right? We are generating the force, means it is a mechanical energy. That mechanical energy converted into the electrical energy. That mechanical energy is converted into the electrical energy. So this particular mechanical energy converted into the electrical energy, and that is given to the input of the recorder, and it is going to be indicated on the indicator. And a part of this particular indicator, it is a feedback path. A part of this particular indicator is taken and it is passing through this particular circuit and finally given as an input to this particular one. This particular position detector is going to be performs a comparison operation. How much we are expecting, what is the current position, it is going to be taken care by the position detector. And the dashpot is the one which is going to be takes a means of frictionless movement from the in the downward direction or in the upward direction. So this is example for two-wire landline feedback system, landline telemetry feedback system. It is a two-wire one and this is a three-wire one. We are using the power lines. So the main intention of the landline telemetry system is we can use the landline telemetry system not for the long distances actually. It is only for short distances. If at all the paths, whatever the cable which we are using, if they are giving the proper characteristics, then what we can do is, if they are giving the satisfying characteristics, then what we are going to do is we are going to use the landline telemetry system to a long distances. In that, as I said, we can't go with the voltage telemetry system, but we can go with the current telemetry system if at all the paths are perfect. The whatever the connecting wires which we are using, if they are the perfect one, then we can go with the current telemetry system. We can't go with the voltage telemetry system. We have seen the reasons also. The reasons are whatever the communication wire which we are using, they may or may not have the uniform, means the resistance of that particular wire is changing. If the resistance of the communicating wire is changing, obviously the voltage drop is going to be changes. Voltage drop across the terminal wire is going to be changes.
obviously at the end we are not going to receive the actual information. So that's why we are not taking the voltage telemetering system for the long distances, but we can go with the current telemetering system for long distances up to 30 kilometers or 40 kilometers. Okay, so this is about the landline telemetering system. Of course, in the using the landline telemetering system, as I said, the physical, we are having the physical path existence between the transmitter and the receiver, between the transmitter and the receiver. So that particular transmitting path may be the telephone cable, or that particular transmitting path may be the coaxial cable, whatever the physical path which we are using. So based on the physical path, as we have seen, the telemetering systems are of two types. One is a landline telemetering system, another one is a radio frequency telemetering system. Okay. So here, the landline, this is the conclusion of landline telemetering system. This is the conclusion of landline telemetering system. So let us go back for a while. So landline telemetering systems are of three types. We have done with that. So the next one is a radio frequency telemetering system. Radio frequency telemetering system. The question comes that, what is the use of the radio telemetering system and where we are supposed to use the radio telemetering system is the question. So as we have seen, radio telemetering system is purely the wireless communication. Purely the wireless communication, not the wired communication. It is purely wireless communication, not for the wired communication. Where we are going to use the radio frequency telemetering system is, as we know, it may be in the satellite communication, it may be in the aeroplane communication, to communicate with the aeroplane, and it may be even we can take our smartphones also. Nowadays we are having the smartphones, and we can track the smartphone position with the help of the GPS. So that particular GPS is working based on the telemetering system only. So the radio frequency telemetering system is going to be used for the long distances, which are long distances, and that to the measuring end is keep on moving. Means it is not taking only a constant position, it is keep on changing. At that time we are going with the radio frequency telemetering system, not with the landline telemetering system, because the landline telemetering system is nothing but there is the existence of physical path between the transmitter and receiver. But in case of the radio frequency telemetering system, we don't have the existence physical path. There's a wireless communication between the transmitter and the receiver. There's a wireless communication between the transmitter and the receiver. Okay, now. So this is all about a brief explanation of the radio frequency telemetering system. Now, when you are going for the radio frequency telemetering system, how the information is going to be transferred? So we have seen that there are some electrical variables, now parameters like voltage, current, the frequency, impulse, all those things. So when we are going for the wireless communication, we are going to send the information in terms of the frequency or the impulse. But when you are taking the radio frequency telemetering system, at that time, the communication between the transmitter and receiver is a line of sight one. Means it is a straight line transmitter. It is not the curved one. For example, let us suppose if you want to transmit one information from one end to another end, what we are supposed to do means we are supposed to take care of the curvature of the earth also. For example, I would like to communicate with one of the aeroplane which is in the fly. Okay, now, so when it is in the fly, I would like to communicate with the aeroplane, that is a pilot who is there in the aeroplane. So for that, what we are doing is we are doing the telemetering system. So when you are trying to communicate with that guy, obviously there are so many antennas which are working to communicate with that particular guy. Why? Because when you are trying to send the information using the wireless communication, they are using the straight line communication. Because of that, we are supposed to use line repeaters. There is a amplifiers. We call that one as amplifiers or the line repeaters. They should be installed for every 30 to 60 kilometers range. So it purely depends on how much strength is there in the transmitting signal. Depending on that, the repeaters are going to be used. What is the intention of the repeater? Means line of sight means, for example, I'm standing right over here. Then I can means that if I want to see something, it should be in the straight direction to my eyesight. If it is not in the straight direction of my eyesight, then obviously I can't observe the scenarios which is happening outside a particular room or outside a particular building. Okay.
So if you want to see that one, it should be in the straight format. If there is a curve, let us suppose I'm in the on the top floor and I would like to see something which has happened in the ground floor. So obviously I have to take a walk on the top floor and I have to bend myself to see what is happening on the ground floor. Okay, so means there is a curvature. So it is similar to that. We are having the earth now. Earth is not a, what is that, flat one. It is a curved one. So when the earth is in the curved position, in order to communicate from one person to another person, obviously when you are using the radio frequency telemetering system, they are expecting the line of a straight line of sight, straight line of sight. So in order to give the communication, they are going to install the repeaters. So when you are using the repeaters, let me take one diagram to explain it. So we are having the curved path like this. So means I'm not good in drawing. So assume that this is my earth. So I would like to communicate with this person. And I'm means this is the receiving end. And over here I'm having the transmitter. So this entire thing is a earth. Okay. I'm having the transmitter over here and receiver is over here. But the waveform which we are transmitting using the radio frequency telemetry system, it is expecting the straight line. So when it is expecting the straight line, it is going to be strikes the earth over here and it is not penetrating through the earth and reaching the receiver. So it is a straight line. The communication means the signal which is passing, it is not the straight line. It is a straight line. It is following the straight line, but the signal is cannot be propagated through this particular earth. Because of that, what we are going to do means, instead of taking this one, means in order to communicate this transmitter with this particular receiver, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to install the repeaters. I'm going to install the repeaters. So the towers, we call it as the towers. I'm going to use the repeaters. Now, what will happen? So this guy is able to see this particular tower now. So the signal is going to be transmitted to this one, from this guy to this one, and finally we are able to see this particular receiver now. So it is a straight line path. So means when you are trying to send the information using the radio frequency telemetering system, so the signal is going to be transferred in the straight line paths. Okay, now. But when you are taking the earth is not a flattened one, flattened planet, it is a curved one. Okay, now. In order to communicate the transmitter, this is an example. In order to communicate one person who is residing over here to another person residing over here, or otherwise I'm having the base station over here, and my flight is moving over here, it is flying right over here. Okay, now. So in order to communicate this one, it is not possible directly because our signals are the straight line signals, so it cannot propagate through this particular globe. So because of that, what we are going to do is we are going to use the repeaters, which we call it as the antennas, and they are going to be installed for every 30 to 60 kilometers range. So that purely depends on that the distance between that antennas purely depends on the strength of the signal. As we know, so if the strength of the signal is less, then the repeater is going to be installed for every 30 kilometers range. If the signal strength is more, the repeater is going to be installed for every 50 to 60 kilometers range. Okay, now. So means these antennas are going to be installed for every 60 to 70 kilometers range like that. Okay, now. So here the information is going to be, means this one is going to be used as LOS. If you are going through any textbook, you will come across one thing called as a line of sight. So if you are trying to send the information from here to here, so it is not, means the transmitter is unable to see the receiver directly. Because of the curvature of the earth. Because of that, we are satisfying this particular LOS concept for this particular communication using the repeaters or the antennas. So from here to here, here to here, from here to here. So this is what we are, this is a concept which we are using in the radio frequency range. Okay. So here in the radio frequency telemetering system, we can send the information in terms of the frequency, or we can send the information in terms of the pulses, either in terms of the frequency or in terms of the pulses. Okay, we can send the information either in terms of the frequency or in terms of the pulses. Okay, so when you are going for the pulse format, the pulse format. Pulse format. So when you are trying to send the information using the radio frequency telemetry system, obviously the information is going to be transferred either in terms of the frequency or in terms of the pulse. Means we are supposed to send the information using the frequency, a electrical variable which is nothing but the frequency. Then obviously we will come across one terminology called as a modulation. We will come across one terminology called as a modulation. So modulation is nothing but the weakened signal need to be transferred from one end to another end for long distance using the wireless communication means. Obviously, we are using the modulation. Modulation is nothing but weakened signal is superimposed on the strengthened signal, which is nothing but the carrier signal. The carrier signal is going to the one which is going to be carries the low frequency signal to the receiving end. Low frequency signal to the receiving end. At the receiver, we are having the demodulation operation. So the demodulation is going to be separates the carrier. What is that information signal from the carrier, and that information is the signal is going to be processed, and finally it is going to be either if it is a visible one, it is going to be displayed on the screen, or if it is a audible one, then it is going to be played at the receiving end. But the problem is when we are going for with the help of the radio frequency scenario, the problem is we'll come across the frequency allocation, the frequency spectrum allocation. Means the bandwidth facilities are going to be changes. Means if you are going to communicate, if you are trying to communicate multiple channels, then you require the multiple frequency bands allocation, frequency band allocation for each channel, separate allocation for each channel. So at that time, the bandwidth which is used for communicating the devices is going to be the increasing one. It is going to be increased one. So to avoid that one, means, for example, let me take one live example. We are having the TV channels. All of us are having the TV channels. Okay, right. So the TV channel is able to going to be relay multiple channels. Means using one either cable connection or in the DTH format, we are able to have the multiple channels, like 100 channels or 100 range channels. Not a single channel. We are going to come across the multiple channels. Okay. Right. So all those multiple channels are able to pass through your DTH antenna or pass through your cable. Now the question comes that how all those signals which are having the different frequency bands, different frequencies, how they are able to propagate through a particular coaxial cable is a question. What kind of technology they are using in order to transmit the multiple channels over a particular wire, over a single wire. So when you are taking one channel, that frequency is different. And another channel, let us suppose I'm taking the TV9, that channel frequency is the one thing, and I'm taking the NTV, that channel frequency is the another one. I'm taking the Ma TV, Gemini TV. Means for each TV, in order to transmit the signal related to that particular TV, there is a separate frequency band allocated. But when we are taking the DTH or the wired communication from the local cable connection, we are going to use only one communication path. We are not using the separate channel, separate antennas for each channel. If we are doing like that, then definitely if you want to receive the 100 channels or 100 antennas need to be used. But it is not like that. All are integrated into one frequency band. They are going to be transmitted from one end to another end. Now the question is, what kind of tricky point they are using in transmitting the multiple channels using only one frequency band, how they are going to be process that one is a question. So that we are going to see in one topic called as a PAM, pulse amplitude modulation. We are having the PAM, pulse amplitude modulation. Another one is a pulse code modulation, which we are going to see in the next class. If you are having any doubts regarding the landline telemetry system, we are going to you can post the questions in the WhatsApp group. Before that, as I gave the explanation, a brief explanation of the radio frequency signal. So that purely depends on the spectrum, the frequency spectrum which we are using. But as the number of channels are increasing, then obviously the frequency allocation is going to be increases. Okay, now all those things we cover in the next class. Okay.